Welcome to St. Matthew's Lutheran Church. We're so glad you're with us today. To any visitors, we extend a particularly warm welcome. We hope today's service is a blessing and a comfort to you all. A lot of announcements. Let me get started here. Today, there's a Dutch lunch at the workshop, and that's hosted by Faith and Friends. Faith and Friends, where will y'all gather, or do you just meet there? Just meet there? Anybody? Janelle, just meet there? So for the Dutch treat lunch today, meet there. Just meet at the workshop, and the address is in Parish News. Parishioners from St. Matthew's will gather tomorrow at 10:30. All are welcome to walk in the MLK parade. We're going to meet at 10:30 at Hampton Park. And it's a very manageable walk from there. We'll end over around Mother Emmanuel, and everyone's welcome to be part of that. This Tuesday, we will begin our study of the Psalms using the book Songs of the Faithful. I'll have books, if they came in, I'll have them this Tuesday. If not, we'll wait another week. But we'll start our discussion of the Psalms this Tuesday. That's at 11 o'clock. And also prayer, noon prayer returns as well. Excuse me. We also have another book called The Weight of Mercy. It's our St. Matthew's first book group book. I encourage you, if you want to participate in this discussion, to get a copy of the book. And we will discuss in the future. Our book group will work a bit different, but for this time, the author, Deb Richardson Moore, will be with us on March 10th. That's on a Sunday morning. She'll lead our Sunday morning class and then be our guest preacher to talk about the book. I would encourage you to get a copy and be part of that conversation. Also, tickets for the Oyster Roast are on sale. Folks will be present during Courtyard Koinonia to also sell them after worship today. Details are in the in Parish News as well. WHAM returns this Wednesday with a special celebration meal. It's very important that we plan for a good count. So please fill out, if you're willing to come, the weekly record at the back. And if you haven't come to WHAM, start a new tradition in 2019. We'd love to have you. Our class also returns this coming week on Wednesday using the book Bread for the Day. If you don't have a copy, I'll have copies this Wednesday at 7. The class will be a bit abbreviated, though, because we have a pit count, point-in-time count for the homeless at 7:30, and you're also welcome to be part of that as well. Let's see. While I'm thinking of it, liturgy today. As we go through our liturgy, it's a new liturgy. This is our third week, but we're still learning it. For this is the feast. So Jason will play through the refrain one time, and note that it repeats. So he'll play it two times, and then the cantor will sing it two times, and then we sing it two times. So you'll see, you'll catch on. But he'll play twice, and then the cantor will sing twice, and then we sing twice. The congregation only sings the refrain. The cantor sings the verses. Pastor Blaylock and Ida will be moving to the upstate. Pastor Blaylock served two. Are you here today, Blaylocks? No? So they are going to be moving to the upstate to be nearer family. And he will be here next week as preacher and presider. I would encourage you to come, bring others, and make this a special sort of farewell send-off. He served two interims here at St. Matthew's, and they're beloved, and we hate to see them go, but we understand that it's time for them to go be with family there. So anyway, he'll be here next week. Ida will too. We have a series of welcome gatherings coming up as we welcome new folks into the congregation. If you're interested in officially joining St. Matthew's, please see Russ and Jackie Long. Raise your hands, Russ and Jackie, or see me or call the church office. The youth will host Super Bowl Sunday, February 3rd. Details are in Parish News. Pastor Rebecca's installation here at St. Matthew's is going to be on February 10th. The day before, on February 9th, at her home church in Good Shepherd, Walterboro, will be the ordination. So Pastor Rebecca says the church is somewhat limited in space, so we can have up to 60 people here from St. Matthew's come. If you're interested in going, please call the church office. Also, we have a series of cottage meetings coming up. To meet, for the purpose is twofold. One, to meet Pastor Rebecca. Second is to discuss the book When Helping Hurts. the small group experience. We'll make these books available for those who want to participate in the next few weeks. So watch for details about that. The deadline for participation in the St. Matthew's mission and service trip to Tanzania is almost here. Please see John Burbage immediately if you're interested so that we can continue planning for this. There are some XYZ events coming up in February. On February 20th, the XYZers will host the Wham Meal. If you're interested and able to help, just in part with that, please call. Just call me, I guess. Call me, and we'll go from there. Amanda McNulty will also be with us on February 13th. Amanda McNulty is the NPR personality who talks about gardening things. She was here 2 years ago and was a big hit. She'll be back for Wham on February 13th. And I think that's it. Are there any other announcements? I was away this past week for training with Russ and Jackie, Pastor Rebecca and Fran Fisher, so I feel like I'm not really prepared. Any other, were there any temple talks that we had? No? All right, let us turn our hearts to worship. Please stand as you are able and face the processional cross at the entrance of the church. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who shines in glory, clothes us in compassion, and bears gifts of mercy for all. Amen. Let us confess our sins with confidence in God's promise of forgiveness, kneeling as we are able. God, wonderful counselor, we confess that we have turned from our gifts and chosen our own way. We have not made room for any in our hearts or in our world. We have lived in fear. We have not welcomed the stranger. We desire gifts that will not endure. Forgive us our sins, known and unknown, and open us to receive the peace of Jesus, dwelling in and among us. Amen. God's loving kindness has appeared to us in Christ our Savior. We are saved, not by anything we have done, but by God's mercy poured out on us richly. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Through the Spirit living in you, God give you faith to trust Jesus, who is love born for you, now and always. Amen. Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy. the feast of victory for our God. Alleluia, alleluia. This is the feast of victory for our
Let us pray. Lord God, source of every blessing, you showed forth your glory and led many to faith by the works of your Son, who brought gladness and salvation to his people. Transform us by the Spirit of his love, that we may find our life together in him, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. You may be seated.
A reading from Isaiah. For Zion's sake, I will not keep silent, and for Jerusalem's sake, I will not rest, until her vindication shines out like the dawn, and her salvation like a burning torch. The nations shall see your vindication, and all the kings your glory, and you shall be called by a new name that the mouth of the Lord will give. You shall be a crown of beauty in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God. You shall no more be termed forsaken, and your land shall no more be termed desolate. But you shall be called, My delight is in her, and your land married. For the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a young woman, so shall your builder marry you. And as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you. The word of the Lord.
Thank you. reading from 1 Corinthians. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brothers and sisters, I do not want you to be uninformed. You know that when you were pagans, you were enticed and led astray to idols that could not speak. Therefore, I want you to understand that no one speaking by the Spirit of God ever says, "Let Jesus be cursed," and no one can say, "Jesus is Lord," except by the Holy Spirit. Now, there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are varieties of services, but the same Lord, and there are varieties of activities, but it is the same God who activities all of them in everyone. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. To one is given through the Spirit the utterance of wisdom, to another the utterance of knowledge according to the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another gifts of healing by the one Spirit, to another working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another the discernment of spirits, to another various kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. All these are activated by one and the same Spirit, who allots to each one individually just as the Spirit chooses. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the second chapter. On the third day, there was a wedding in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine gave out, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." And Jesus said to her, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? My hour has not yet come." His mother said to the servants, "Do whatever he tells you." Now standing there were six stone water jars for the Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 or 30 gallons. Jesus said to them, "Fill the jars with water." And they filled them up to the brim. He said to them, "Now draw some out and take it to the chief steward." So they took it. When the steward tasted the water that had become wine, and did not know where it had come from, although the servants who had drawn the water knew, the steward called the bridegroom and said to him, "Everyone serves the good wine first, and then the inferior wine after the guests have become drunk. But you have kept the good wine until now." Jesus did this, the first of his signs, in Cana of Galilee, and revealed his glory, and his disciples believed in him. The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. Boys and girls, please come forward. Grown-ups, this would be a good time to fill out the weekly record and parish news. Hello, boys and girls. How are y'all today? You okay? It sounded a little down. Is everything okay? You just tired? Well, let's try it again. Good morning. That's a little better, I guess. So, the Bible story today, the one that Mr. Chris read, Mr. Altman read, made me think about gifts and the fact that we all have all these different gifts, these things that we're good at. What's something that you're good at? What's something you're good at? Can any of, as I look here, as you think, can any of you do miracles? No? Can any of you prophesy? Probably not. I know. What do you think? What are some of the things you're good at? Being creative. That's good, Parker. Being creative. What else? Yes? So what? Drawing. Yeah. Yes. Jiu-jitsu. That's a gift. That's a gift. Yeah. What else? Sports. Yeah. So some of us are good at these things. Some of us are good at drawing. Some of us are good at sports. Some are good at both of these things. Some are good at jiu-jitsu. Some people don't even know what jiu-jitsu is. Yes, what about you? Say that one more time. You do that too. That's good. So all of these things that we're good at. Yeah, that's good. All of these things that we're good at, you know who gave us that gift? Who gave us that gift? God gave us that gift. I want you to, if you have bangs, pull your hair aside. Up here, there's an invisible mark on your foreheads here. That's, you know what that is? No, it's not a Harry Potter scar. No, no. It's a cross. It's a cross. It's a cross that was made when you were baptized. And in that cross, God claimed you. Like Pastor Rebecca last week said that we all get new names at baptism. We're called children of God. But also what happens is God gives us a vocation. God gives us gifts then and equips us to go do things we never thought we could do, whether it's drawing or sports or jiu-jitsu or whatever it is. And those things that we're good at, that God gives us, those gifts that God makes us able to do, we go out and then serve other people with those. And that's a good thing. That's a good thing. Oh, no. Yeah, it is. Yeah. Let's say a prayer. Good and gracious God, thank you for claiming us and naming us and giving us gifts that we can use to go and serve out in this world. In your holy and precious name we pray. Amen. All right, have a good week. Be well. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. So what's not to love about a sermon where Jesus makes 175 gallons of wine? Can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right. So those at our 9 o'clock class know the inside joke on that one there. Okay. And it's good wine at that. What an unusual season this time after Epiphany is. Talk about variety. First, we had the wise men 2 weeks ago following the star to the toddler Jesus. Then last week, we had the baptism of our Lord Jesus and all the imagery of water and word and naming that Pastor Rebecca talked about. That baptismal theme continues today, and you'll be able to hear it in some of the hymns and on all of the language of our liturgy. But we also have today the wedding at Cana, and this imagery of great abundance of grace, and abundance of gifts. Epiphany marks many things, the revelation or manifestation of Christ to all nations. Jesus' baptism and growth in our own baptismal identities. Christ as light of the world, and today, the beginning of Jesus' public ministry. And this is demonstrated by his first miracle, the first miracle of turning water into wine, the wedding at Cana. 6 jugs of wine, of water, which Jesus, quick as a snap, turned into wine, all 175 gallons of it. So what is this story about, this wedding at Cana? In short, this story and all the readings today are about abundance of grace, an abundance of gifts. In today's gospel, we hear of a wedding at Cana, an event to which Jesus and his mother and his disciples are invited. The wine gives out, and Mary turns to Jesus and says, "They have no wine." Jesus' response, I find very funny, and shows that the Bible does contain humor. Jesus says, and I quote, "Woman, what concern is that to you and me? It's as if Jesus is saying to his mom, they should have hired a better wedding planner. What are we supposed to do about it now? But this is where something very, very significant happens. Like mothers often do, Mary is beside Jesus, encouraging him, spurring him on, urging him to act, to do something about the situation. To the servants, Mary says, do whatever he tells you. And what does Jesus do at this point? He performs the first miracle of his public ministry. Jesus turns 6 stone jars of water into 175 gallons of wine, filled to the brim, an embarrassment of riches in great abundance. And it's not just wine, but it's good wine. And that's also worth noting. Back in the early church, wedding celebrations typically lasted a week, and guests would celebrate for the entire time with a great feast and lots of wine. The host would serve the better wine first when the guests could still taste what they were drinking and determine which was better. And then they'd bring out the inferior wine later in the week. In other words, the Barbersville Octagon Meritage would be served first, and then the Franzia would come out at the end of the week. And there was Mary encouraging her son at the first public miracle. And she'd be there with him at the end too, wouldn't she? At the cross. Jesus' wine is always good wine, the best stuff. Love overflowing, grace in abundance. The story of Jesus turning water into wine at the wedding of Canaan is an epiphany story through and through. God's abundant grace is manifested right before the people's eyes. And just as is the case so often in God's work, there's a good dose of mystery in Jesus' action at the wedding. We don't know how Jesus turned water into wine, just like we don't expect a cruel cross to be a sign of life, or how we don't expect dying to lead to rising, or how we don't expect or even understand how Jesus can really be fully human and fully divine at the same time, or how we don't fully comprehend how Jesus can be truly present in a morsel of bread and in a sip of wine, or how we don't expect a rough-looking, motley group of sinners like us, you and me, to be the body of Christ. But God's grace and love are abundant, indeed an abundance of grace and abundance of gifts. But today's lessons refer to another kind of abundance of gifts too. To those other gifts, we look to the second lesson, the one that Chris read, to the reading from 1 Corinthians. Listen again to Paul's words. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are varieties of services, but the same Lord. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. This letter of Paul's written to the Christians in Corinth in about 54 is an affirmation of our spiritual gifts. These gifts that I talked about with the boys and girls just a moment ago is Paul's way of reminding us that we all have been given special gifts and talents to use in service and in thanksgiving in this life. The passage is a reminder, a call that we are to live out our baptismal identities, those things that God calls us to be. God's abundant gifts are showered upon us, God's children, all of us, so that we may name, recognize, and employ those gifts for serving our neighbors in thanksgiving. Paul's words also were written to advise the Corinthians that even though they were diverse and given various gifts by the Holy Spirit, all were children of God, united in the one body of Christ. Paul's message is the same for us today. The abundance of gifts that God gives us does not divide us, but rather God's abundance unites us all in the one body of Christ. You know, St. Matthew's is poised to receive an abundant gift. In the context of abundant need for care in our church community and the abundance of the time and heart that some of our congregation can provide, St. Matthew's is now a Stephen Ministry congregation. Founded in 1975 and now in more than 13,000 congregations from a variety of Christian traditions, Stephen Ministry is a one-on-one lay care ministry provided within a congregation and maybe beyond. There are three primary groups associated with Stephen Ministry: the Stephen leaders, who teach and supervise the ministry; Stephen ministers, who, after an application process and extensive 50-hour training, provide one-on-one care to others; and then care receivers, who agree to have a Stephen ministry to walk with them, to accompany them in difficult times. Pastor Rebecca, Fran Fisher, Jackie Long, Russ Long, and I returned last night from an exhausting and exhilarating week of Stephen leader training. The five of us have much work to do in the weeks and months ahead as we began to select and train the first class of Stephen ministers here in late summer, early fall, maybe sooner. You'll be hearing much more about Stephen ministry this year. But for now, think of Stephen ministry in the context of Paul's words to the Corinthians: the abundance of gifts that God gives us does not divide us, but rather unites us in the one body of Christ. Today's gospel uses the image of the wedding to tell us about God's abundant love and grace. There was no wine, but suddenly God made possible abundant, good wine. There was waiting for the Messiah, and then God made possible the first public miracle of the Messiah. There was despair in the world, and then God made possible a unified body in the one true God. Let's say it another way, using the wedding imagery. We are married to God, chosen by God in love, and bonded and bound until death in mutual service and joy. For us Christians, human marriage becomes a welcome metaphor for our relationship with God, and conversely, the ideal relationship that we hope Christian marriage would be. Turning water to wine was Jesus' first public miracle. But why? To be candid, it seems like a silly thing to do, doesn't it? It doesn't seem particularly worthwhile, especially when we're talking about God's power in the context of all the needs in the world. Turning water into wine seems more like a David Copperfield trick. Why would Jesus do this? Why couldn't Jesus perform something bigger or more useful for his first public miracle in his ministry? But then we think about how God works. God's power always seems to be revealed in understated, odd, unexpected ways. Prophets prophesying with speech impediments. Powerful kings who were scoundrels. Disciples who ran amok, abandoning and betraying the Lord Jesus. The Savior of the world, born homeless to lowly parents in a cattle stall. Yes, it is cliche to say, but God does work in mysterious ways. The point of the water into wine miracle, I think, is not simply to demonstrate God's awesome power. Rather, God can do anything and everything at any time to bring about God's promises. God can use the stone jugs of water to demonstrate power and promise. And using the abundance of gifts given to each of us by the Holy Spirit marked upon our foreheads at baptism, God can also use us, you and me, as vessels for showing work and power. The Sundays after Epiphany continued to celebrate the revelation of the glory of God to us as it was made known to the Magi, as it was made known to those on Jordan's banks at Jesus' baptism, and as it was made known to the guests at the wedding at Cana. God insists upon showering us with an abundance of grace and an abundance of gifts. God rejoices over us as the bridegroom rejoices at the table over the bride. By the power of the Holy Spirit, there are gifts in abundance for everyone. And in Christ Jesus, the best wine is saved for last. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Let us confess our faith using the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Dwelling in the presence of God with us, let us boldly pray for the church, the world, and all in any need, kneeling as we are able. We pray for the church. Strengthen bishops, pastors, deacons, and all who lead your people in ministry. Pour out your Spirit and make us bold to proclaim your reign of mercy and justice. Hear us, O God. For the earth, for vineyards and orchards, fields and gardens, urban parks and wilderness areas, fill the earth with your abundance and provide for the needs of all living things. Hear us, O God. For the nations, guide leaders and decision makers toward the well-being of all in their care. Strengthen those who work to uphold human rights for the sake of the dignity of all people. Shelter communities threatened by violence and show us the way of peace. Hear us, O Lord. For those in need, for those who face a scarcity of resources, and those who struggle with debt, for all who suffer with chronic pain, all who grieve, and all who are ill, especially this morning, we pray for all of those on our parish prayer list and those we name now in our hearts and on our lips. Hear us, O Lord. For this assembly, transform us and fill us with your life so that we may pour out your love in service to the world. Bless all who work to provide food for others. Hear us, O God. We pray for our Stephen leaders and our upcoming Stephen ministers and the entire Stephen ministry that will transform the lives of so many here, and indeed the life of this congregation. Hear us, O God. For Ella Grace Hill, daughter of Matthew and Elizabeth, granddaughter of David and Mary Beth, upon her birthday Friday. Hear us, O God. For youth and chaperones as they enjoy a ski weekend under the care of the Luther Rock staff, protect their travels and bring them back safely. Hear us, O God. With thanksgiving, we remember those who have died in faith, especially Charles Otherson, brother of Beeman, upon his death. Inspire us by their witness and unite us in the eternal light of your presence. Hear us, O God. Trusting in the presence of God by the power of the Holy Spirit, we commend all for whom we pray, dwelling in the light and hope of Christ our Savior. Amen. The peace of Christ be with you always. Let us share this peace with one another.
Holy God, your beauty shines forth from the manger and your love flows from the cross. As you gather us around these signs of your love, come among us. Warm us to extend your care among the hungry and all in need. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and Merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ. By the leading of a star, he was shown forth to all nations. In the waters of the Jordan, you proclaimed him your beloved Son. And in the miracle of water turned to wine, he revealed your glory. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Beginning and the end, the giver of life. Blessed are you for the birth of creation. Blessed are you in the darkness and in the light. Blessed are you for your promise to your people. Blessed are you for you in the prophet's hopes and dreams. Blessed are you for Mary's openness to your will. Blessed are you for your son Jesus, the Word made flesh. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. Broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Let us proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
With this bread and cup, we remember your word dwelling among us, full of grace and truth. We remember our new birth in his death and resurrection. We look with hope for his coming.
Come, Lord Jesus.
Holy God, we long for your spirit. Come among us. Bless this meal. May your word take flesh in us. Awaken your people. Fill us with your light. Bring the gift of peace on earth. Come, Holy Spirit. All praise and glory are yours, Holy One of Israel, Word of God incarnate, Power of the Most High, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Taste and see that the Lord is good.
Thanks be to God.
the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Radiant God, with our eyes we have seen your salvation, and in this meal we have feasted on your grace. May your word take flesh in us that we may be your holy people, revealing your glory made known to us in Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Amen. Will the congregation please be seated for a moment as we commission our Stephen leaders and the overall Stephen ministry here at St. Matthew's. As Fran comes forward, Russ and Jackie and Pastor Rebecca. So as we do this liturgy that's appointed by the materials here, Pastor Rebecca will mark our signs, our head, foreheads with the sign of the cross during the prayer. So I'm actually being commissioned here, so this is a little awkward. So just we're commissioning ourselves. If y'all will face them, and we'll just do the best we can here. All right. As Christians who are part of the priesthood of all believers, all of us are called to offer ourselves to our Lord in thanksgiving for what God has done and continues to do for us in Jesus Christ. But it is also our privilege to recognize and support those who are trained for specific ministries in this congregation here at St. Matthew's, especially today as we recognize and affirm our Stephen leaders who will direct this ministry. Because of your gifts, Stephen leaders, your calling and your training, we charge you with these responsibilities: to build awareness of our growing Stephen ministry, to solicit the commitment of this congregation to Stephen ministry at every opportunity, to recruit, select, and train thoroughly as Stephen ministers those members of this congregation whose gift it is to share one-to-one caring ministry, to use the resources of our community as appropriate to enrich the training and ongoing supervision of Stephen ministry in this congregation, to assign the trained caregiver who most appropriately fits a person's need, to supervise these confidential caring relationships, and offer regular opportunities for continuing growth in the skills and practice of caring ministry. I ask the Stephen leaders now, will you assume this ministry in the confidence that it comes from God? If so, respond, we will, and we ask God to help us. We will, and we ask God to help us. Will you nurture the skills you have learned and use them in service to others to support, encourage, build up, and heal people in all their needs? If so, respond, we will, and we ask God to help us. We will, and we ask God to help us. I ask the congregation, as you all stand, as you're able, will you open your hearts to the ministry of Stephen leaders and Stephen ministers and care receivers and pray for them? If so, answer yes with the help of God.
Yes, with the help of God.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you have called these leaders to lead us into these new paths of this caring ministry. You have gifted and empowered us. Grant us service in a spirit of bold trust in you, that our ministry may stir to greater caring and more fruitful service at St. Matthew's. Help us all to be both willing servants and thankful recipients of this ministry, so that your name may be glorified, your people live in peace, and your good and gracious will be done. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. All receive this blessing. May the Lord of the church fill you with the Holy Spirit and guide, bless, and keep you so that you may be faithful in the ministry to which you have been called, gifted, and trained. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
called to celebrate, grow, and serve in Christ's love. Go in peace. Christ is near.